If you're curious about the parachute cat in the thumbnail, I'm going to start with that. Would you believe if I told you that cats are actually parachuted into a certain location? Back in 1950s, in the Sarawak region of Borneo, it's an island near Malaysia, there was a huge malarial outbreak. So WHO had to intervene and they decided to control the population of mosquitoes because they were the carriers of malaria, and DDT is a very effective in controlling the mosquito population. So DDT was spread all around the region, and rightly so, it controlled the population of mosquitoes and the incidence of malaria decreased. But something else happened too. They noticed that the cat population rapidly declined in a few months, and of course, because of the cat population declining, the rat population increased rapidly. Now what had happened was that the little insects in the Borneo Sarawak region had consumed DDT, and these insects were consumed by the geckos, and the geckos were in turn consumed by the cats. The poisonous DDT had an effect on cats, and the cats started dying, and the population of cats started declining rapidly, and because of that the population of rats started to flourish, and there was an outbreak of plague. They had to actually parachute in cats and drop cats into Borneo, and this was even termed as Operation Cat Drop. Well, the specifics of the story are still contested, but it makes the point that we're trying to make. So here the problem was that they tried to address the problem of malarial spread without considering the system-wide effects. They only consider the first-order effect, that is, mosquitoes being a carrier of malaria, and hence you have to control the mosquito population, and that they try to do with DDT. But the problem is they did not think about the second-order effects of the cats and rats and subsequently the plague. So this is the problem with linear thinking. When you think in the paradigm of cause-effect, you might end up proposing solutions that are very short-term, and those solutions might even end up causing larger problems in the future. A more holistic form of thinking would be thinking in systems, or thinking in closed loops, where you bring in multiple elements and also acknowledge the interconnectedness of the elements in a system. Today, systems thinking has been acknowledged as a necessary perspective in solving some of the major problems. I am no expert in systems thinking. I'm also just starting out. I'm also just learning. I was fortunate enough to be introduced to systems thinking back in B school, where I took a course on systems thinking, and two amazing professors introduced me to it. So in this video, I just want to introduce you to the paradigm of systems thinking. We will not go deep into it. So it will just give an overview of systems thinking, just enough to understand what is systems thinking and why it is different from linear thinking, and get some tools to get you thinking in a systems manner. So hey guys, welcome to Being Wise, where I discuss transformative ideas gathered from books, the internet, or from anywhere else on this planet. If you haven't already subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe. I post at least 2 videos every week on personal flourishing and insights from books and films. So what are the core aspects of the systems approach or systems thinking? The first is to understand that a system will have multiple elements and they are all interconnected. In the example of the Borneo cat situation, there was malaria, mosquito, there was DDT. But there was also cats, there were also geckos, there were also insects, and there were also rats. So the malaria problem and the rat problem was interrelated. The second thing is systems thinking has feedback loops. Now, if you look at all systems in nature or in this world, it is always a closed loop. If you look at the water cycle, then it's a closed loop. You have water flowing from rivers, going into the sea, and that evaporates from sea, and the water bodies, it goes up into the atmosphere, and that comes into rain, back into rivers in the sea. So it's a closed loop. If you look at the carbon cycle, that's a closed loop. So most systems in the world and in nature are closed loops, and that's why systems thinking will always come with closed loop. And any system will have a pattern. The core belief of systems thinking approach is that the pattern that is produced by the system is due to the structure of the system. You would see that there are some solutions proposed. Take the example of even the Borneo cat situation. There was a solution proposed. It was effective in the short term, then they controlled malaria, but in the long term they created a disaster. In linear thinking, you act upon events and you are reactive. So there's a certain event happening and you react upon it. Your solution is for that event. If you take one step backward, then you will notice patterns. There'll be a set of events, and from that event you will notice patterns, and you can also act upon the patterns. It's a more prudent way, but it's still not the best way. You can act on the patterns, you can predict future patterns based on what happened in the past, but not always reliable, because past does not always predict the future. When you take a step back from the event, you have patterns. But there is also something that creates the pattern. If you have to reliably predict the future and propose very sustainable long-term solutions, you have to understand the background of the patterns. You have to understand the system structure that produces the pattern. And that is where the system comes in. So there is event, pattern, and the system structure. Now, when you intervene in the system structure, then your interventions are much more sustainable, effective, and they are long-term oriented. If you take one more step backwards, there is also mental model, but I'll not go into that in this video. So here we would say that, you know, we would work on the system structure, because the thing is that you have, if you have to make a change, then you have to impact at the high leverage points. And the high leverage points generally you would find in the system structure. What are these high leverage points? The points where if you act upon, you're able to make the maximum impact. And that is there in the system structure. So only when you understand the system, you will be able to get the kind of outcome that you want. So what we have now established is that all systems have a pattern of behavior. And what we are trying to do in system thinking is either we see the pattern and try to recreate the system behind it, trying to draw up the structure of the system, and then we are trying to influence the pattern by making intervention in the system. But if you look at the structure of systems, let's just go into it just for a couple of minutes. All systems consist of basically reinforcing loops and balancing loops. So what's a reinforcing loop? Now this can be understood with the example of money and the interest you make from it. Take you have a certain amount of money in your bank account and you're going to generate an interest from it. Say you're not going to spend this interest is going to go back into your account. So you get some interest. Now that with that interest you have more principal right now, and with the more money you will have more interest, and that more interest will mean you have more money. So this is a positively reinforcing cycle, and you see the pattern that is created by this system. It's positively reinforcing, it goes exponentially up. Now what is a balancing loop? Take the simple example of food consumption and hunger. When your hunger goes up, you will consume food. When you consume more food, your hunger reduces. So this is a balancing loop. Hunger will impact food consumption positively, like more hunger will lead to more consumption of food, but more consumption of food will reduce your hunger. So that is an indirect relationship. So this is a balancing loop. So all systems consist of balancing loops and reinforcing loops. You know, they could have multiple balancing loops and multiple reinforcing loops. Take this example of a simple concept of population that consists of both a reinforcing loop and a balancing loop. Population will determine the number of births. Of course, the birth rate is also a factor here. More the births, the population will increase. And if there's more population, you could expect more births. So this is a reinforcing loop. What happens on the other side? The deaths. When you have more population, you will have more deaths. When there are more deaths, the population will reduce. So here is a balancing loop. And depending on the death rate and the birth rate, if the birth rate is more than the death rate, then the population will increase in the long term. If the death rate is more than the birth rate, then the population will decrease in the long term. So this is a simple system. And now we have understood the simple concepts of reinforcing loop and the balancing loop. So when you want to build a system or understand a system, you use these reinforcing loops and the balancing loops to build the system that you want to build so that it produces the pattern that you desire. Another aspect of system thinking is that we inherently acknowledge the delays in the system. Now delays are an inherent aspect of most systems. Now take this very simple example where you switch on your air conditioner at your home and set the temperature at 20 degrees Celsius. Now the room does not immediately become 20 degrees Celsius. Now there is a time delay before the air conditioner works for some time, and then the room cools down to 20 degrees Celsius. So there is a delay there. So that is there in every system, and that makes managing systems much more complex. That makes our problems more complex. If you go back to the Borneo cat situation, now if the cats had started dying immediately after they started spraying the DDT, then they would have realized the problem much earlier. But the cats started dying only after a few months, because, you know, there's a whole system. It has to be consumed by the insects and the geckos, and it has to be consumed by the cat, and the DDT has to start working on the cat. So there was a delay there, and makes it more difficult to correlate our action and the actual impact. Now, you should, of course, you know, we all have certain bandwidth of brain power and certain capacity processing. So you have to, when you're trying to solve a problem or trying to think through a problem, you have to draw a system. Yes, we have to look at it in a very holistic way. We have to bring in multiple elements. We have to think in an interconnected way. We have to think in a systems way. But for every problem we take up, we cannot, you know, analyze the whole world. So we have to draw system boundaries, and we have to draw the boundaries in a logical manner, saying that, you know, things beyond the system boundary will not have a major influence on what I'm trying to achieve. Let's look at a couple of examples from the, you know, from the business context. What would be a reinforcing loop from a business context? Let's take a very simple example. Say you have a product, you're making a lot of sales. A lot of sales and customer satisfaction will lead to more word of mouth. More word of mouth will lead to more sales. You will have more market share. More market share means more word of mouth. And see, that's a positively reinforcing cycle. Now, what could be a balancing loop in a business context? Now, say that you have a very attractive market. So what's an attractive market? It's somewhere where you can make lots of money. There's a lot of opportunity for profit, and there are very few competitors. So to start with, a particular market is very attractive. Now, what happens when the market attractiveness is very high? A lot of competitors will come in. When a lot of competitors come in, there is often a price competition, and the price goes down. Price for your product or service goes down. When the price goes down, the profit you can make goes down. When the profit you can make goes down, the market attractiveness goes down. So this is more of a balancing loop. In the end, an equilibrium is maintained. But if you look at the bigger picture, some of the most wonderful products that we've enjoyed, or some of the most wonderful business models, have a certain aspect of systems thinking to them. Take the example of Apple iPod. It's a great product because there are multiple things that comes together. There's this beautiful hardware, and there's this software to go with that. And there is also the content, the iTunes and the copyrights, everything that has been worked out so that you can easily download music from iTunes, and you can sync it very easily. Take the example of Amazon Kindle. It works in a similar manner. You have a device, you have a software that's designed beautifully, and you also have, Amazon also has this catalog of ebooks. So again, it's an ecosystem design. Take the example of great business like Southwest Airlines. Now, for a low-cost carrier, they have to get multiple things right. It's not just about reducing your cost, right? It's about your route planning. It's about getting your training right. It's about getting your turnaround times right. So there are multiple things that has to operate together to get your strategy to work properly. So those were the ideas that I wanted to discuss in this video. I know this video was a bits and pieces video. There were bits and pieces of ideas. I just wanted to throw out some ideas so that it will encourage some curiosity in you. If any part of this video or any idea in this video made you curious, please go read more about systems thinking. It's an amazing perspective, and there are amazing online resources that are available right at our click. There are blogs there. I'm going to link up all the resources that are in the description box below. So in this video, I just discussed the theoretical framework, the conceptual framework of systems thinking. But what we did back in our course was that we also modeled and simulated the systems. We built these models in a free software called Benson. So we used to model them and simulate them, and then come up with solutions to whatever problem we were dealing with. It could be public policy issues or business issues. So if you're really interested in learning to model systems, I would recommend this free set of videos by IIT Bombay on YouTube. It's by Professor Jayendran Venkateswaran. I saw first few videos of this, and it was very similar to what I was taught back in my course. So if you're interested in modeling and dwelling deeper, do check out that course. So that was the idea for today, a more wise way of thinking, the systems thinking approach. So I'll meet you next time with another idea. Until then, goodbye and thanks for watching.